بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه وبعد. Respected brothers and also sisters listening, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Batley is awake, alhamdulillah. I'm sure you are all here not to see my face, or anyone else is here, maybe other people are not to listen to me. We are all here, myself included, to listen, to sit in the company of, be in the presence of one of the greatest, if not the greatest, scholars alive today. He shall be arriving, and I believe there was a long session today after Dhuhr Salah here, so he was a bit tired, and therefore he will be coming, inshallah, very soon. And as you all know, when you don't have water, what do? You perform tayammum. So right now the water is not here. So you have to suffice a bit with tayammum, inshallah, until the water arrives. And then the qa'idah is that when you find water, then إِذَا جَاءَ الْمَا بَطَلَ التَّيَمُّمْ تَيَمُّمْ becomes invalid. So inshallah the water will come soon. Just briefly, I just want to talk about, and I'm sure all of you, there's great ulama, and I feel quite embarrassed to speak in the presence of some of the great ulama here. Shaykh Abdul Shir Rabbani, he is actually a colleague of Mufti Taqi Usmani, Hafidahullah, in Karachi. They studied together under Mufti Shafi Rahimullah. And there's some other great scholars. I'm just a student. Just briefly, some things I want to mention. A lot of you know who Mufti Taqi Usmani is. But what I want to say is that there are some ulama, some scholars, there are ulama and then there are ulama. Okay, without sort of making levels between people, but there are certain scholars who are scholars for scholars. There are certain ulama who are scholars for other ulama, and their benefit reaches the general public through other scholars. We've had them in history, and there are very few in the world like that at one given time. So the rest of the scholars are listening to them. They are benefiting from them. And then they are preaching the public. So the public are indirectly being benefited from those great scholars. Many of the Jumu'ah bayans you hear today, in many of the masajid in Urdu or in English, many of the bayans, the imams who are doing bayans, the ulama who are giving you durus, and they are giving majalis, they are actually reading the books of someone like Mufti Taqi Usmani. I've seen many, many great scholars who actually prepare their talks, even their Jumu'ah bayans, and they are reading Mufti Taqi Usmani's Islahi Khutbat, 24 volumes. So he is an alim for the ulama. There's a saying in Arabic, إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ الْفَضْلِ لِأَهْلِ الْفَضْلِ ذَوُ الْفَضْلِ إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ الْفَضْلِ لِأَهْلِ الْفَضْلِ ذَوُ الْفَضْلِ. The virtue of the people of virtue is only recognized by those of virtue. Shall I repeat that again? The virtue of the people of virtue is really recognized by those of virtue. So if someone has virtue, to really appreciate and recognize, you have to have a bit of virtue yourself. A doctor will recognize another doctor. General public, now this guy looks like a doctor, he's got an iPad in his hand. Who is a great doctor? The people with a bit of understanding of medicine will realize this guy is a great doctor. One engineer, mechanic, will understand the expertise and the level of another mechanic. The real scholars, people like Mufti Taqi Usmani, Hafidahullah, he is more valued by the scholars of this ummah because they have ilm, they have knowledge. I mean, I have said this many times, and I don't think, alhamdulillah, I did study with, but many other people have studied with him. I think Shaykh Mazraji, who's from here as well, is a friend and colleague of mine. I don't know various, but he also studied with Mufti Taqi Usmani in Darul Uloom Karachi. I was there in 1999 and 2000. I actually mentioned to him a few weeks ago when we were somewhere abroad. It's been 20 years since I studied. He looked at me and said, 20 years? You look like 20. So he couldn't believe that it was 20 years. A lot of people who, the ulama, they recognized his virtue. Like I was saying, one mechanic. So this Mufti Taqi Usmani, hafizahullah ta'ala, may Allah protect and preserve him. He is an alim for the ulama. And I also normally say that we are privileged to be living in the same era and breathing in the same era that he is living. There was one great alim who passed, I can't remember, recall right now, who actually said that it is as though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a group of great ulama. People like Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana al-Shafri Thanwi rahimahullah, Hujjat al-Islam Mawlana Qasim Nanutwi rahimahullah, Shaykh Rashid Ahmed Gangohi rahimahullah, Mawlana Ilyas rahimahullah, Shaykh Hussain Ahmed Madani, Shaykh Zakaria rahimahullah. There was a group of scholars, they were all going somewhere, and they all left, and one person was left behind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And seriously, if you look at his life, his work, his expertise, you know, Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana al-Shaf'ali al-Thanwi rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the greatest scholars produced in the subcontinent of India. He was recognized by other ulama as a mujaddid. Mujaddid is somebody who is a reviver. There's a hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he says that Allah sends after every 100 years, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْعَثُ لِهَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ عَلَى رَأْسِ كُلِّ مِئَةٍ مَنْ يُجَدِّدُ لَهَا دِينَهَا. Someone who revives. The sign, I remember many years ago in Blackman, Mufti Taqi Usmani actually gave a talk on this hadith, and he explained how Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana al-Shafi'i Thani rahimahullah was a mujaddid, meaning he has expertise and services in every different field, in every field of Islamic learning. And normally what happens is that when one great mujaddid passes away, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala straight away brings another person like that into this world. The year Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiya anhu passed away, which was year 150 Hijri. Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah passed away in 150, the same year, some people say same day, not the same day, but the same year who was born? Imam Shafi'i, jazakallah. The same year. In 1943, Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana al-Shafi'i Thani rahimahullah passed away. 3 months later, Mufti Taqi Usmani was born in 1943. I'm not saying he is a mujaddid or not, only Allah knows best, but we can understand, and the works are very similar. If you look at it from a scholarship perspective, and this is what the ulama understand, from a scholarship perspective, a lot of people think Mufti Taqi Usmani, yes, Islamic banking. That's just like his side thing that he's done. He's mentioned so many times that I entered the field of Islamic finance and out of necessity and need. It's my least favorite subject. Imagine, if that's his least favorite subject and this is what he's done to that particular field, then imagine his favorite subjects. I entered this field as a necessity because there was nobody else in that field. Out of necessity, I entered this field. He's not just an Islamic finance alim who just regulates banks and things like that. That's just one part of his job. If you look at every field of Islam, every field, if you take the Qur'an, his services to the Qur'an, I can talk about this openly, alhamdulillah, because he's not here. Otherwise, in his presence, it's impossible to say these things. In terms of Qur'an, he has a translation. Many of you should have this. If not, please buy it. Read his translation of the Qur'an in Urdu as well as in English. English is not a translation from Urdu. He himself translated the English and he himself translated the Urdu. The Urdu one, 3 volumes, or sometimes they publish it together. Asan Tajrume Qur'an Tashrihat Kesat. And in English, the meanings of the noble Qur'an, 2 volumes. If you don't have it, please buy that. It's he's written it for all of us. We should all try to understand the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Understanding the basic meanings of the Quran is not restricted to the ulama and the scholars. This is why his father, Mufti Muhammad Shafi rahimahullah, wrote Ma'arif al-Quran. Ma'arif al-Quran was a summary and simplified version of Bayan al-Quran, which was written by Mawlana Shaitani rahimahullah, because that was for scholars. So Ma'arif al-Quran is for the public. This is actually a point that many of our general public, we just about read the Quran, but we never understand the meanings. I remember once I was traveling from somewhere, and there was this Christian priest or someone sitting next to me in a train, and we started talking about religion. He said, look, I just have one question which I don't understand. Anyone who is like, thinks himself as a serious Christian has definitely read the Bible and understood. But I don't get it. 90% of you Muslims don't have a clue what's in your book, the book that Allah sent to you. It's like, you spent 80 years, you've been on every website, and you've been on every, different newspapers and everything we've had time to read. But the time we don't find is to read the meanings of the Quran, the book of Allah, that Allah sent to me and you. How can we live a life of 60, 70 years and we don't even know what Surah Al-Fatiha means? Like, we read it every single day. You know, if you know the meanings of Surah Al-Fatiha and then pray Salah, your Salah is completely transformed. And then if you know the meanings of the Quran, then you don't really rush into Tarawih as well. And you don't start complaining when someone's reading slow. How many rak'ah left? Because you're not enjoying it. Because it sounds Chinese to you. But if it's not, if you're understanding the words and the meanings, it's a complete different feeling, complete different emotion, experience, totally. So this translation of the Quran is something that you should... I was saying that his contribution in the Quran, his contribution in Hadith, there's so much contribution in the Quran, but the translation is just one thing. He has a book called Ulum al-Quran, Sciences of the Quran, and some other things. If you look at Hadith, he has a 6-volume, he actually completed it, but commentary of Sahih Muslim in Arabic. Imam Muslim wrote a Sahih. We have Bukhari and we have Muslim. Sahih Muslim, Imam Nawawi, who lived in the 7th, 8th century, he wrote a commentary called Al-Minhaj. And some Imam Rabbi and some other great Imams wrote commentaries, Shuruhat. In Arabic, Mufti Taqi Usmani completed his commentary, writing for 18 years. In 1976, he started a commentary just before his father passed away. And it was actually upon the instruction of his father that he should complete this commentary of Sahih Muslim, Takbilatul Fath al-Mulhim. It took him 18 years. In 1994, he completed this. And he's mentioned a few times that he used to have a dedicated 2 hours every day that he would spend, to write his commentary. He teaches Hadith, Sahih al-Bukhari, for many, many years. His lectures of Sahih al-Bukhari are published in 10 volumes in Arabic, in Urdu. He's been teaching Tirmidhi for many years. All the students and graduates from all the Darul Ulooms, everybody knows that's Tirmidhi. In India, in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, everywhere. All the Urdu-speaking countries. There's no one student in any madrasa in Indian subcontinent who's not benefited from the works and books of Sayyid al-Bukhari. He was once saying, I think a few years ago when he came here, we were going somewhere in Bradford actually, and in the car he was saying that each book of mine has been translated by 4 people in Bangladesh, in Bengali language. Like, they all have a competition who translates. Every book of his has been translated like 4 times by different scholars. Ulama are translating his books into Bengali language. And so, so this is his Hadith. And then also, you must have heard that there's a massive, there's a big project that they started in Darul Uloom Karachi under his supervision of collecting all the Hadiths that are there, which will approximately come to about 35, 40 volumes together, etc. A lot of contribution in the Hadith field. If you look at Aqeedah as well, do you know, some of his works are such that people dedicate, this is a sign of a Mujaddid. I'm not saying he's a Mujaddid, and it's difficult to claim, but we have indications. Some people, they dedicate their life to one thing, and that's what expertise, you can't do too many things. But his work in every field is similar to someone who is dedicated their life to that field. So like, for example, if you take Aqeedah, you have people like Ahmed Didat, you have, whoever, Dr. Zakir Naik, or whatever, dealing with Hindus, or Ahmed Didat is very known for Christianity. That's like a chapter in Mufti Taqi Usmani's work. And the reason why we don't, when someone has so much different work, you don't realize their work in one field, because they're not just daily talking about that one thing. He has a book called Bible Se Quran Tak. He mastered Christianity inside out, read the Bibles and the sources inside out. There's a book called Idhar al-Haq in Arabic. Mawlana Rahmatullah Kirami wrote this book. He actually translated it, wrote a commentary, and then this Bible Se Quran Tak. It's a masterpiece work in dismantling Christianity. And he wrote an introduction to it, which is called What is Christianity? It's in English, in Urdu, Isaiyat Kya Hai, in Arabic, Masiyat Asraniya, three languages. And this was actually a book, when he wrote it in Urdu, Shaykh Abul Hasan Ali Nadwi Rahimullah, he actually said that this should be and must be translated into English and in Arabic. And he said, I'll pay for the costs, and he got it translated into English and into Arabic. In Khatme Nubuwa as well, like we have people who are, their whole life is Khatme Nubuwa. Very good, alhamdulillah. His work was the reason why Qadianis in 1974 were considered to be non-Muslim minorities in Pakistan. One book, he wrote it in 1 week. It's in English as well, which was presented before the Assembly, National Assembly of Pakistan. What was it called? The Qadiani Fitna. And the stance of the Muslim Ummah. That's the English translation. Qadiani Fitna or Millat Islamiya ka Mawqif in Urdu. Over a week under Shaykh Yusuf bin Nuri rahimahullah's guidance. And this was presented before the National Assembly of Pakistan. And because of that, in 1974, Qadianis were considered to be non-Muslim minorities. This is an aqeed. These are just works that people would dedicate. You might do your whole life of 15 years of work for something like that. He's just done that in a week. You're looking at Quran, you're looking at Hadith, you're looking at Fiqh. We're looking at different, what else field? Tasawwuf and Tazkiyah. SubhanAllah, like, what can you say about that? There are people who, alhamdulillah, dedicate their life for Tasawwuf and Tazkiyah. They become bay'ah, they stay in the company of a sheikh, then they have murids, they have majlis and khanqah and dhikr and this and that. Mufti Taqi Usmani is a sheikh of tasawwuf. But why we don't realize sometimes he is one? Because he's not spending his morning, afternoon, night, every day in a khanqah, because that's one chapter of his multi-dimensional services. One chapter. And his tasawwuf is very pure tasawwuf. An amazing type of tasawwuf. A tasawwuf tazkiyah, which is of balance. No extreme to the right, no extreme to the left. It's not something that he... You see, you know, someone said before that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they never had the name tasawwuf, but they lived it. The Sahaba lived tasawwuf, but they never had the name. Many a time in our times, what happens? People have the name of tasawwuf, but they don't live it. Tasawwuf is tazkiyah, it's akhlaq, it's character, it's how you are as a person. It's to do with the heart, tazkiyah. And if you look at his tasawwuf, extremely balanced type of tasawwuf that you can see in many of his works. So even in that field, aqidah field, Quran field, hadith, and the main field that people think, fiqh, he is mufti. Now that's one field. His fatawa, over 45,000 fatawa that is written since the age of about 16, 17 when he first wrote his fatwa. 16. He actually graduated when he was about 16 or 17. Under the guidance of his father, he wrote his first fatwa, published in 4 volumes, Fatawa Uthmani. And all his fiqh articles in different on different subjects. So fiqh is a very important part of his life. And then Islamic finance, people call him a mujaddid in Islamic finance because he presented to the world a non-interest-based system which is possible. In every field, anyway, this is all for the people of knowledge. They understand all of this. For general public like me and some of you, we can't all try to be like him in terms of, you know, after listening to this, somebody might want to write a commentary on Sahih Muslim. Maybe the big people, but people like us, you know, what do we aspire to? Do we want to write a translation of the Quran? Do we want to do all this? That's not for everybody. These are his academic services. For the general public, for us, to understand him. If you stay in his company and you sit with him and you stay, the more you sit in his company, seriously, you see a man who is extremely close to the prophetic way. Now when we say prophetic way, what is the prophetic way? The way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we think about sunnah, way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not disregarding any aspect of it, but first of all, our mind, especially in Batley, just comes to a topi or a jubba or a beard. Sunnah, topi, jubba, okay. Tasbih, sunnah. You know, some very external type of sunnah comes into our mind. These are important. And sometimes eating with three fingers comes into our mind, right foot comes to our mind. These are important, not disregarding it. But when we look at the prophetic way, sunnah, which is of interaction with people, how you are as a human being with other people, the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, if you look at the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had many, many qualities. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had many qualities. But if you want to summarize all of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's character traits and qualities, there's one quality that is the khulasa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had so many qualities. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ Allah said to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we have put you on a pedestal of a very high rank and character. But if you want to summarize one word, one character trait, one quality, one attribute, one sifa of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what would it be? Let someone take a guess. Yeah, but one thing from the akhlaq. Tawadu is there as well. These are all the things there, but there's one thing that comes, it's very close to that word. Sorry? Jazakallahu khair. Yes. Abdiya al ubudiya, slavehood. Innama ana abd. Sorry, I didn't see you sitting in front of me. Astaghfirullah. How can I stand and talk? Innama ana abdun. Akulu kama yakulu al abd. Wa ajlis kama yajlis al abd. I sit like a slave sits. I eat like a slave eats. He said that himself. In the beginning, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he would sit with the Sahaba, he did not want a prominent place. He never used to sit like a big peer, buzruk, shaykhia, sahaba, mere peer, baba, baba. He never used to sit like that. He would sit in the middle. When someone used to come, they would ask, man minkum Muhammad, who is, which one of you is the Prophet? Then they would say, هذا الرجل الأبيض المتكف, this one, fair complexion, just leaning there. They couldn't recognize him. The Sahaba had to force the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They said, look, Ya Rasulullah, what's happening is that people are coming and then they're asking and they can't really, we need you to sit a bit slightly different when you're teaching so they could recognize that who is the teacher and who is the student. So then finally he understood that, okay, so then they made a small place for him to sit with the elephant. But otherwise he would be in the middle. There's hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go on a campaign with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and what would happen is that he would say, okay, who is going to collect wood? Who is going to burn the wood? Someone go and get this. Someone, and he would say, my duty is I'm going to get wood. The Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, you don't have to do anything. He said, I know you guys don't want me to go and do this, but I hate the fact that I am distinguished amongst you. I don't want to be mumtaz, distinguished. Ubudiyya, slavehood. You know what ubudiyya means? Ubudiyya means that we think we are abd of Allah, slave of Allah. I am nothing. I am a slave of Allah. Once we bring that in our hearts and minds, the way we talk to someone becomes different. The way you talk with family members is different. The way you treat your husband, the way you treat your wife, the way you treat your children, the way you treat your students. SubhanAllah, so many examples. Just recently, Mufti Usmani, just 2 days ago, there was a student of his who came to meet him. Now this is a teacher and a student. Normally what happened? He stood up for the student. I mean, very rare examples of your own student coming to meet the teacher and him standing up. I've heard from his talks that sometimes Torah said, you know, when someone meets you, at least make some movements. If you're reclining on a sofa, you will never ever see Mufti Taqi Usmani sat as it is when any human being, even a non-Muslim, comes. Because he has ubudiyya, he doesn't think anything about himself. One of his great qualities from this ubudiyya is that respect of others. I personally haven't seen anyone from the scholars who gives respect to others as he does. Respect to his peers, respect to his own students. He calls, in many of his writings and books, he doesn't say, Mera shagird ne ye likha. He'll say, my brother, my colleague. He's a student, but he calls him my brother. He calls him my colleague. Imam Ibn Hajar Asqalani, rahimahullah, his student Imam Sakhawi says that our Shaykh Ibn Hajar used to be such that he would always refer to his students as my colleague. Because they don't think anything of themselves. He considers his students to be like my colleague, my brother. The respect he shows to his juniors, respect to fellow peers, respect to non-scholars. That is a branch of the teachings of Mufti Usmani. How to deal with non-ulama. You know, we hear this, sorry for the graduates and ulama, al-awam, al-awam, kal-an'am, ula-jahal, bal-hum adal, awam. I personally, I don't even like the word awam. Awam, so we're khawas, like, what khas are we? They're aam and khas. Everyone's aam according to Allah. Give respect, and this is for students like me, give respect to non-scholars. Every human being is worthy of respect. Every human being, a Muslim is especially worthy of respect. Give them respect, you'll get respect back. I've not seen a scholar who gives non-scholars as much respect. Sometimes say he doesn't have a beard. It's like, you know, just sitting, look down at him, stuff. I mean, how is that possible? When you have rubudiya, the person, even if he doesn't have a beard, you will stand up for him, give him respect for being a creation of Allah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that love the creation of Allah. أحب الخلق إلى الله من أحسن إلى عياله. The most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is good towards his creation. So part of his ubudiyya, this is I'm saying that this is what you can learn from his life. Giving respect to other people. Giving respect to other people because you're considering yourself to be a slave, an abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would give this respect. Another thing from ubudiyya, and I'm concluding, is tawadu'. Like Shaykh Yusuf Darwan just mentioned, if you ask a lot of people who know Mufti Taqi Usmani, mention one great quality of his. Straight away, tawadu comes into mind. Like tawadu, humility. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, من تَوَاضَعَ لِلَّهِ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهِ. Whoever is humble for the sake of Allah, Allah elevates him. Allah has given him this status, Allahu A'lam, today, because of his extreme level of humility. You know, sometimes some things are built in, you're created with it. Imam al-Ghazali says in his Ihya Ulumuddin, that good character, sometimes you're born with them, and sometimes you have to work for them. If you're born with them, thank Allah, you know, you're lucky, you're fortunate. So you don't have to work too hard. Some people are born naturally angry. Some people are naturally born calm as a cucumber, like they say. Like, so calm. It's just natural. Maybe their parents were cool. But if you're not, then you have to. There's no excuse that Allah made me angry. No. There's no excuse that Allah made me an angry person. The struggle, this is mujahada. You have to work to remove anger from your disposition. So he is also naturally, you know, created someone who is like very humble. Sometimes names have an effect as well. His name is Taqi, Muhammad Taqi. Actually, he mentioned once that his father, who was very close to Hakim al-Ummah, Mawlana Aisha bin Khalid, used to have a child born in his house, he used to ask Mawlana Aisha bin Khalid, rahimahullah, to suggest a name. Hakim al-Ummah, rahimahullah, used to give him a list. Even there, you take something. He never said, keep this name. Like a dictator. Give him a list, 10, 15, whichever you like from here. And even if you don't like any from here, no problem, take another name. Nowadays people are scared to ask my Shaykh a name, and if I don't keep it, you know, this whole thing, it's sometimes very problematic, it creates problems. He used to give him a list and say, if you want this, any of these names. So his father used to pick from there. And then when Mufti Uthmani was born, Hakim al-Umma had passed away. So his father said, every time for my previous children, I think he's the youngest of the whole family, every time in the list, Muhammad Taqi used to be part of the list. So his father chose that. The word Taqi, Taqi means what? Pious. He has an impact. Because you know, why does he have an impact? Names are like du'as. Every time, if your son is called some good name, and every time you're calling him, if it's called Abdullah, for example, you are saying, oh Allah, make him the abd of yours. Oh Abdullah, you are making dua. That's why, keep good names for your children, not fancy names, good names. Inna min ahabbi asma'ikum min Allah ta'ala Abdullah wa Abdurrahman. Most beloved names to Allah is Abdullah and Abdurrahman. Fahassinu asma'a abna'ikum. إنكم تدعون يوم القيامة بأسمائكم وبأسماء آبائكم. You will be called with your names and your parents' names. فحسنوا أسماء أبنائكم. Give good names to your children. So this has an impact. تقي تقي هو التقوى. So I was just saying, to finish this off. Humility. If you see his humility, it's just on a ridiculous level of humbleness, of absolute humility. Those who stayed with him will recognize this humility of his. Also, part of this ubudiyyah, I said respect to others, giving importance to other people. These are all prophetic qualities. Each one of these qualities, we can cite examples from the seerah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, the Sahaba Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu says, I thought that I was so close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because every time I used to meet him, he used to give me so much love and attention. I used to think I'm the most beloved. So I said, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved to you? And I knew he was going to say me. Because the way he's treating me, he said, Aisha, he said, from the men, me, of course, Abuha, his father, then who, Umar, Uthman, there's some variations in the hadith. He said, I stopped asking because I didn't want to get more disappointed. Because Aisha thought that I was the closest to him because the way he would deal with me. Every Sahabi thought that I'm the closest to him. You see, Mufti Muhammad Taqi, the way he deals with every person, the words that come out, the sweetness that comes out from his mouth. You know, he was traveling somewhere, and you know, I met him 2 days ago, so yeah, it's just words of sweetness. So, missed you in the trip. Now, I'm thinking like him, he said the same thing to another person. Luckily, I heard that. He is close to everyone, yet not exclusively attached to anyone. He is close to everyone, yet not exclusively attached to anyone. This balance is rare, because exclusive attachment are the ones the people who create fitna around you. You know when you get all those people who are in politics, there's no politics around him. I'm just being very frank and open in today's talk, I don't know. But very... there's no politics around him because there's no one that controls him. He's his own person. He's a very academic type of person. Very academic type of person. So, showing love to others. One of his other salient qualities, such as here as well, mashallah, is he always has a smiling face, cheerful countenance. Again, a sunnah. Meet with your brother with إِنَّ مِنَ الْمَعْرُوفِ أَنْ تَلْقَى أَخَاكَ بِوَجْهٍ طَلْقٍ. One of the virtuous actions is to meet your fellow Muslim brother with sister meeting a sister and brother meeting a brother with a smiling face. We don't smile at brothers, don't smile at brothers, and with sister, then we've got a big smile. Meet with a smiling face. He's always, hardly seen him. When he meets or someone greets him, he doesn't have a very innocent type of smile. Very, very rarely. Even in travel, he's traveling. Imagine you're tired, you're exhausted, still smiling face. This is again a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We all hear smile, sunnah. But remember, this smile, sunnah is not a business type like of smile. There's a difference between a real, honest, sincere smile. But you don't really want that person's money, you don't want that person's help, you don't really want anything, you are only smiling for the sake of Allah, for your reward in the Akhirah. We can only do this when we want the rewards in the Akhirah. We smile with those who smile with us. We are good to others, when they are good to us. But if they're not good to us, then who's going to survive? This is actually totally against the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said in the hadith, what's the hadith? لَيْسَ الْوَاصِلُ بِالْمُكَافِئِ وَلَكِنَّ الْوَاصِلُ الَّذِي إِذَا قُطِعَتْ رَحِمُهُ وَصَلَحَ. Real maintainer of ties is not the one who maintains ties when others maintain time with him. If someone's good to you, you're good to them. That's simple. That's just basic humanity. If we didn't do that, we wouldn't even be human beings. That's normal. No big deal. Real big deal and real maintainer of ties is the one when people cut you off, people break their ties with you, people don't treat you well, you still treat them well for Allah's sake. And you leave them to Allah. Our reward is in the Akhirah. If someone's not smiling, then okay, I'll still smile at them. If someone's not nice to me, I'll still be. Because I want my rewards in the Akhirah. And this is the teachings of Mawlana Ash-Shafi'i Thanvi Rahimullah especially. You know, one of the reasons why Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana Ash-Shafi'i Thanvi Rahimullah was called a Mujaddid, because he explained in the subcontinent the real meaning of tasawwuf. In the subcontinent, people thought tasawwuf was only dhikr al-kar, khatm al-ajal, tasbih. These are things of tasawwuf. But they restricted tasawwuf to certain things. You just wear a dress and you go and do dhikr al-kar, that's it. And then you can have a fight with someone whilst you're driving cars. You're fighting with a businessman down there. You've got a contract disagreement down there. You're fighting about some property there. You're swearing down there. He said, this is not real tasawwuf. Like, the dhikr and all of this, that's like the side dishes or the masala or the achar or whatever you want to call it. Real, if you have a cake, the real cake is your tazkiyah, your interaction. Then the icing is the dhikr majlis and all of that. But today tasawwuf has become the icing, the masala or the achar or the dessert or the, you know, the, what's before? Dessert is at the end, starters. We've made all of tasawwuf and Islam into the starters and the desserts, the real part of tasawwuf. And, you know, I've heard this again from Mufti Usmani and probably in his books as well. He had a brother called Mawlana Wali Razi Rahimahullah. I don't know if he can speak on his way because I don't know when he's here. Mawlana Wali Razi, he had a brother called Zaki Kaifi Rahimahullah, his elder brother. Just, I think, for a few moments, I'll be here, inshallah. He had an elder brother who passed away. Before his father, he passed away. He was a Sha'ir poet, Zaki Kaifi Rahimahullah. When he became 7-8 years of age, he learned how to write, you know, how to write. So his father, Mufti Shaykh Rahimullah, said to him that now you've learned how to write, what you do is write your first letter to our Shaykh, Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana Shaykh Rahimullah. So he wrote his first letter as a 7-8 year old child in Urdu, posted it, sent it to Thana Bawul when Hakim al-Ummah Rahimullah was there. Hakim al-Ummah Mawlana Shaykh Rahimullah read the letter, he wrote an answer to the 7-year-old child, and he wrote in there, MashaAllah, it's very pleasing to know that you've now learned how to write, and I would suggest to you that keep on improving, work hard in improving your handwriting. Beautify your handwriting. And then he said, look, the intention you make in beautifying your handwriting, this is his brother, Hakim al-Ummah saying to his elder brother, Mufti Taqi Usmani's elder brother, the niyyah intention when you want to make your handwriting good is that, you know what, when I write, I have the intention that I do not want to inconvenience any person that I write to. I don't want to give the teeth. Nowadays people text messages, you know, like there's no comma, there's no full stop, there's you, it's like you, short. It's easy to write full text. There's no, when you write a text, it's easier, spell whatever that code, whatever it's called, just give you the word. But people write no commas, you have to read it twice. I just send the text message back, please, I can't understand. It's taking me 5 minutes to try to understand what you're saying. It's better to just write and then reply back, it'll be 2 minutes. So please just add some commas and full stops and write back. So I don't really know what's happening. Inconveniencing others. And then the final part, what Mawlana Ash-Shafi'i Thanvi Rahimahullah said, amazing. This is the point, this is the line to really understand. He said, make his intention that I don't want to make inconvenience to anyone else. And then the last line, they call me abhi, main tumko abhi se sufi bana raha. I am making you a Sufi from now. Improving your handwriting is tasawwuf. Shaykh Taqi Usmani says that. Who would think improving your handwriting has anything to do with tasawwuf? We think tasawwuf is dhikr and khatm-e khajgan and this and that. What's handwriting going to do with tasawwuf? That's the real tasawwuf. Tasawwuf is you live a life where you do not inconvenience, harm any creation of Allah. Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna bil lisani wa yadihi. Neither with your mouth, neither with your hands, or with your writing on Facebook, on social media, or with your ishara, your gestures. We live a life that no neighbor, no one is inconvenienced. And if we do, we straight away go and seek forgiveness from Allah. That's a real Sufi. This is the Shaykh of the Sufi. Anyone who's like that, whether he has hundreds of murids or not, this is a Shaykh. And someone who has thousands of murids and all of that, but if he doesn't do this, then he's not a Shaykh. Real tasawwuf is someone who lives that type of life, where there's no one inconvenienced from his actions, from his interaction. So I was just saying that this part that, I forgot what I was saying, but this, meeting everybody with a cheerful countenance. This is a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not a business type smile where you want something from someone. Jarir bin Abdullah al-Bajri says, I've never met the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam except that I always saw a smile in his face. So I'm going to end with this inshallah. These are like, and there's one or two other qualities of his as well. From this ubudiyya. Actually, last year or the year before, I remember I wrote this whole article and I got it published online. Six prophetic character traits of Shaykh al-Islam Mufti Taqi Usmani. And I listed all of them and gave examples. I wrote the first one, cheerful countenance, talaqatul wajh, gave examples and how it's connected to the sunnah. Then there was another one, making others feel important, and then mentioned some hadith and how he makes people feel important and how that is in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number three was treating everyone with respect. How he treats everyone with respect and how we see that in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number four was humor. I didn't talk about humor. I gave some examples of his humor. I've seen a few, very humorous, very jovial. You see that the humor is just a very regular type of person. There's no, you don't feel any, force or any pressure, anything. Oh, something's going to happen or naraz ho jayenge or anything. You don't worry about any of that kind of stuff. He's a very clean hearted person. You see the same humor in the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know the famous story of the Sahabi called Zahir radiallahu anhu. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from behind him, put his hands on his eyes, and he said, "Man yashtari hadha al-abd?" Who's going to buy this slave of me? You know, like we say, guess who it is? Imagine Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yeah, no Shaykh al-Hadith. Greater than Shaykh, greater than the greatest Shaykh, greater than anyone ever. You're going into the market and you're going behind someone. Guess who is it? This was the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why Sahaba fell in love with him. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَرِيدَ الْقَلْبَ الْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. And this is why people like Mufti Taqi Usmani, those who have spent some time with him, there's no way except that you will fall in love with him. Just as a person, you will fall in love with him, because this is how he follows the way of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So his humor as well. And then the fifth one I wrote, humility, tawadu, and simplicity. I've mentioned that as well. Sometimes walking looks like a regular uncle. You wouldn't even know. There's been examples like somewhere he's walking in London, and no one even recognizes who he is. Simplicity. And the last one was caring for others. That's an amazing quality of his as well. Six. And that's also from the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Concern and care. We remember we were traveling once. There was a brother who was disabled on a wheelchair. Usman is like every day asking him, "Have you eaten? Have you had your breakfast? Have you had your dinner?" He goes and sees him. When people are moving in his wheelchair, he goes and fix the wheelchair. It's a brother from Blackburn. Young, 22 years old. We were in Bosnia 2-3 years ago. There's a whole group, a lot of scholars went from the UK. And he's helping the wheelchair. There's another one, Molana, who came out of the bus and he tripped and he fell down. First person to run to him was Mufti Taqi Usmani. "I'm running, are you okay, Extreme care and concern for the ummah, for the humanity. These are six that I felt really come out from his life. And then the seventh one came to my mind as well later, I added in, his generosity. He's very, very, very generous. He's charitable. I've seen on many occasions. He's not here. I remember a few years ago, he was in Denmark in Copenhagen, and
I happened to be there as well. The brothers called him, and I know the people in Denmark, so I went as well. And he gave some talks, and actually one of the talks I had to do this demo as well before his talk. And I actually did a Urdu demo at that time. And that was the first time I actually gave a talk in Urdu, I remember, in a public gathering. I've actually given my first talk in my life in Batley Sharif. I've just seen here, I just realized right now he's here. When I was a young child, he used to take my HIFS exams. He used to come Leicester. He's my teacher, my father's his teacher. I spent some time here in Batley, and you know the Jumu'ah Masjid. So one day he held me with the hand. He's a child. I think I was 7 or 8, and before Jumu'ah, I gave a Urdu biyah. Jumu'ah Masjid. I was just telling the brothers that came with me that I remember, I think I was 7 or 8. And I gave a Jumu'ah bayan. I'm just thinking, went past the masjid. So, I don't know what I was saying, but I'm trying to just, tayammum. So, I was saying in Denmark, I'm definitely going to try that. Does anybody know there's concrete? Is there anything else after this? Okay, just 2 more minutes. It's generosity and then finish. And before you come, the brothers, they did not, in Copenhagen, they didn't have a masjid. They were hiring a place, that no purpose-built masjid. So they invited Mufti Usmani, and he said to them, look, one of the most important things for you is for you to have your own masjid. From today, start looking for a place. They were being lazy. He said, look, they had a meeting. Straight away today, start looking. Go and open a bank account today, charitable bank account. Start collecting donations. And from today, within 2 years or 1 year, you need to give me progress reports. I want to see a proper masjid, Shari'i masjid in Copenhagen, Denmark, for the Muslims. He go and open a bank account today. And then he took $2,000 out of his pocket. He said, open the account, 1,000 from me, 1,000 from my wife. Go and put this money and open the bank account for the masjid. It's just one example. Just one example. Every time he travels here, he gives people gifts. All the children of the people he visits, he gives them £20, £50, £60. There's actually, Muhammad Daji might know this, there's actually people in the world he regularly sponsors students who cannot study. He's got a list of people. Regular, yearly, monthly money is going from his account to them. That he's helping, but you have to be a serious person, not somebody who's just gonna just and say, I want some money. People can actually write his office that I'm a student, talib ilm, and I struggle, and his office, they will look at and see. Mufti Shafi rahimahullah was the same. Part of his income, 10% of his income, he used to give in donation. So very, very generous. You know, we were traveling and we came to the airport. This was recently somewhere. He said, the whole group, I'm going to treat everybody. Ice cream, juice, everything, all from me. No, he took his money out. He made sure he paid for everybody's ice cream and juices. I remember in Wales, 2-3 months ago, we went to Wales, and it was about £40. Everyone's coffee, biscuits, everything from me. No, nobody's paying. I'm treating everybody. Some amazing qualities. I mean, there's so many stories we can talk about him, but alhamdulillah, inshallah, we will see him coming. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him. And also, you know that there was assassination attempt on him. Many people know last year. There was assassination attempt on him in Pakistan. And a lot of people wrote and politicians spoke. And there's just so many people spoke about it. May Allah give him a long life, protect him, keep him within our ummah for a very, very, very long time. Very few people like him are left in this ummah. Very few people. Just his presence solves a lot of issues in this ummah. You feel sometimes that someone like that goes away, what's going to happen to the ummah? It's a very scary sort of understanding. The ulama will understand this better. Because he's someone who says one thing, everybody in Batley will be muttafiq and agree. All the scholars will agree. Someone of that caliber. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to follow in his footsteps. I'm sorry for taking too much of your time, and sorry to be a bit frank here and there. I hope you forgive me, inshallah.